Thank you so much for taking time to join us here this morning. Now we're live and connected. Really great. Hey, my name's Cory. If we haven't had a chance to meet, I'm the campus pastor here. I'd love to have the opportunity to meet you after the service. As is already mentioned, we do have our Thanksgiving celebration right after the service. So you'll hear it again, but right after the service is done, certainly we don't want to interrupt you kind of mingling and talking and having a good time with each other. But you can also do that downstairs. So we want to encourage you to take yourselves downstairs and find a table right afterwards. And we were going to begin our great meal that's been prepared for us. And I think you're going to love it. We're going to have a great time a little bit this afternoon right after the service. So thank you for taking some time to gather together to worship. We are in a series right now in the book of Genesis. So if you don't have a Bible this morning, there are Bibles right in front of you in the chair. Just look below the rack, below the seat in front of you, you'll find a Bible. Turn to the book of Genesis. This morning we're in chapters 42 and 43. Genesis is the very first book of the Bible, just in case you're not sure where that is. That's totally good. Just open it up and you will find it. Just go from Genesis all the way to chapter 42 this morning and 43. We have two chapters to cover. They continue to tell us the story of Joseph in this series that you've seen just before I got up here called Intended for Good. And I want to begin this morning just by making a confession to you, actually. You're like, wow, okay. This is, the room just drops in silence. I love it. Here's my confession. I really enjoyed all of the Taken movies. Who here has seen the Taken movies? Okay, now we're all confessing here. Okay, I really enjoyed watching the Taken movies, in particular Taken 1, the very first one with Liam Neeson. Liam Neeson, I will tell you, is one of my favorite actors, one of my favorite guys to watch. And I suppose it might be that the fact that I'm a father with three girls and one boy, but with the three daughters, when I watched Taken, the first one, I couldn't help think about Brian Mills, who is played by Neeson in that movie, who has to hunt down the men who's kidnapped his daughters. His daughter is out on a trip with her friend. They've gone to an international location in France, and they encounter some traffickers who abduct them and take them. And as a dad, I've wondered, when I watch that movie, I think every dad watches it probably and thinks, what would I do? What would I do in a moment like that? How far would I go to fight for my daughters to bring them home? Putting aside what I might think be the right or the Christian answer to this, to throw out sort of cliches at this moment, I need to be honest about this and admit to you that I'm not so sure that my answer would be all that great in a moment like that. And just prior to the kidnapping, you may recall, if you've seen the movie, probably the best sort of paragraph or comment that Liam Neeson makes in the movie when he gets one of the criminals on the phone, and he's a retired CIA agent, right? So this man is highly skilled, and he gets the kidnapper on the phone, and he calmly says these words, and if I had Liam Neeson's voice right now, I would do it. He says, I don't know who you are. I don't know what you want. If you're looking for ransom, I can tell you I don't have money, but what I do have are a very particular set of skills. Skills I've acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you. If you let my daughter go now, that will be the end of it. I will not look for you, I will not pursue you, but if you don't, I will look for you, and I will find you, and I will kill you. From that point on in the movie, Mills hunts down the men that abducted his daughter. And he not only rescues the girls in the movie, but he annihilates absolutely everyone in his path who seeks to stop him. In killing absolutely everyone, Mills ends up killing the adult sons of the man who's in charge of the entire human trafficking ring. And now that man, in Taken number two, because there's got to be a number two, is seeking revenge against Mills. And as you watch the second movie, which isn't as good as the first, you wonder, will it ever stop? I mean, where's the ending of this? Will the cycle of vengeance and retaliation ever end? And the answer is no. It won't, because there's Taken 3. And guys like me can't help it. We're going to watch all of them. It's not until the end of Taken 3, or maybe it will still yet be Taken 4 or 5 or 6, I don't know. But that's when the retaliation finally ends. This is the kind of stuff, though, that happens, isn't it, in seeking vengeance, in escalating the cycle of retaliation just continues. It goes on and on and on and on until somebody says, I'm not going to retaliate anymore. And if we're honest with ourselves in a lot sort of milder ways, I trust, we sometimes desire payback, don't we? Retaliation, vengeance, revenge. We may desire to bring it about, that is, to be the agent of retaliation, or maybe we are more subtle in our desire. We just didn't want bad things to happen to somebody that really kind of did wrong to us. Someone who wounded us or hurt us. The human nature that we have, the sinful human nature, wants to retaliate. We want to pay them back for what they did. Confession number two this morning. No, I don't have any bodies in my trunk. It's a lot better than that. We've started watching Christmas movies already. If you drive by our house at night, the Christmas lights are out already. There's trees up, decorations, the whole works. We are early at it. And I love it. I love the season of Christmas. The very first Christmas movie we just watched is, I guess you could call it a classic because it's like 100 years old now, Christmas Vacation. And it has some moments where you're like, ooh, okay, that's a little edgy. But the movie opens with, remember the opening scene, Clark, the dad? They're driving in that station wagon down the road and on a mountain drive, and they're heading up into the mountains to take down the Christmas tree, right? The dad forgets to take a chainsaw or whatever, and they're up there, and the kids all freeze to death, basically. But they're going up there, but it's the scene that opens up. He's driving down the road. They're all singing Christmas songs as they're driving, and then this pickup comes right on their bumper. You remember that? Riding right on his bumper. And guys, some of you are so much like me on this, and some of you are probably not. But when somebody rides your bumper, what are you going to do? You're going to brake check. And your wife is going to do what? Honey, stop. I can't tell you how many times over the years I've done brake checking. And then, of course, there's the inevitable, like in the movie, pass. The passing lane. Yeah, this guy's going to try to get past me. Of all the things. Are you kidding me? Put the grass down, honey, we're going. And of course, in the movie, that's exactly what happens. And it gets them into quite an ordeal. And, he's quite upset. He ends up swerving into like the underneath of a semi-truck, and he's trying to drive through this. Ends up going off a snowbank and flying into an area, and they crash and things like that. But in simple little ways, that's retaliation, isn't it? Well, I can't believe these people are riding on my bumper. It doesn't take much. But if there was ever anyone who might desire retaliation and vengeance, it's the biblical character of Joseph, character that we've been studying for the last 3 weeks. We've seen in the life of Joseph a series of events from chapter 37 to where we are today, beginning in 42. We've seen how he was subject to significantly harsh treatment at the hands of others, beginning with his own family. And let's just briefly retrace the steps, if you will. And in your outline, I actually provided for you a very nice, colorful chart, by the way, that doesn't cover it precisely as I would like it to, but it gives you the idea. You start off the story in chapter 37. Remember, Joseph is 17 years of age, and his brothers hate him for a lot of different reasons, but he's the favored child in the home, and his brothers end up repulsed by him. They hate him, and they hate him, and they hate him even more, to the point that they take him and they throw him into the pit. They actually want to kill him first. They throw him into a pit, and then traders come by, that is, slave traders come by, and they say, let's sell our brother to these traders. These traders happen to be on their way to Egypt, and so he's sold into slavery. He goes to Egypt, and where does he land? He lands in slavery, but he's in Potiphar's house. So he goes from his father's house down into slavery, but he has this little spike where God shows him favor inside the house of Potiphar. He is handed over the management of the entire house, and yet there lurks in the house Potiphar's wife, who takes notice of him. And she seduces him repeatedly over and over again, and he resists the temptation. He refuses the temptation, and he says, "How could I do this and sin against God?" Finally, one day, she grabs his garment, and he takes off, and the garment comes off, and he leaves. He was stripped of the garment in chapter 37 that his father had given to him. He's stripped of the garment when he flees from Potiphar's house. And now where does he go? He lands up in prison because she falsely accuses him of sexual assault. And there he is in prison for a significant period of time. While he's in prison, he has this little spike of good things happening. He gets favor in the prison, just like he did in Potiphar's house. And in prison, he's entrusted with the care and management of all the prisoners, actually. And then one day, as we saw last week, Pharaoh has two individuals sent to prison. One is the cupbearer, and one is the baker. They did something that upset him. And these two men come into the prison, and Joseph is there. And these two men have dreams. Two dreams with two different endings. The baker's dream tells of his death, and the cupbearer's dream tells of his return back into the presence of Pharaoh as the cupbearer. And Joseph simply says to the cupbearer, "When you're restored back to Pharaoh, remember me. Remember me, because here I am." But he doesn't get remembered. For over 2 years, approximately 2 years, he is forgotten in prison, left there. It's not until Pharaoh himself in chapter 41 has this dream, or these two dreams, that really trouble him, and the cupbearer goes, "I remember, there's this guy in prison who interpreted a dream for me. And actually, he was spot on. He said the baker's head's going to be chopped off, and it was, and I got restored, just like he said." And Pharaoh's like, "Okay, I want to see this guy." So he goes into the prison, reaches down into the prison, if you will, and he says, "I want him to come to me." So Joseph comes out from the prison, and when he comes out of the prison, the prison garments come off of him, and he's given new garments, and he's brought into the king's presence, and he interprets the dream for the Pharaoh. And he tells him in the dream there's going to be 7 years of plenty in the land, 7 years of great prosperity, and 7 years of famine are going to come to the land. And he actually tells him how he needs to manage the situation. And Pharaoh gives Joseph at this point a fine-looking robe to wear, fine clothing and garments, and gives him a signet ring. And there he is in this position of great power over all of Egypt. There's no one other than the Pharaoh himself is higher in authority than Joseph. Talk about a roller coaster of existence for Joseph. Joseph, you see, has at this point plenty of reasons to be bitter, to be angry, to be hateful, to be retaliatory. And for 13 years, from the time he was 17 in chapter 37 to the age of 30 in chapter 40 verse 16, from that period, he's 30 years of age, and he experiences all these ups and all of these downs, largely down. He's constantly, in the chart I have in your notes, it's sort of up and down. It's actually down with a little spike of up, and then down further, a little spike of up, and down further would be a more accurate chart, and then he finally rises to this powerful position in Egypt. And so in last week's message from chapter 40 and 41, we learned that all of his sufferings and afflictions, God made him in command over all of Egypt. And during those 7 years of plenty, Joseph's life is actually really good. Finally, he's hit, as we talked about last week, he's hit the sweet spot, if you want to call it that. His life was filled with sort of the sour patches, as I mentioned. This is the sweet spot. Oh, after all of that. During that time, the text tells us that he had two sons. And I want you to notice in your Bibles, as we pick up the story, in Genesis chapter 41 about those years of plenty. I want you to notice what Joseph has to say, starting in verse 46 of chapter 41. Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went through all the land of Egypt. During the 7 plentiful years, the earth produced abundantly, and he gathered up all the food of these 7 years which occurred in the land of Egypt. And he put the food in the cities. He put in every city the food from the fields around it. And Joseph stored up grain in great abundance, like the sand of the sea, until he ceased to measure it, for it could not be measured. Before the year of famine came, 2 sons were born to Joseph. Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bore them to him. Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh, for he said, God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house. The name of the second he called Ephraim, for God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. The 7 years of plenty that occurred in the land of Egypt came to an end. So he is in this 7-year period of great plenty, and God blesses him with these 2 children. But the 2 profound statements he makes are in verse 51 and 52. God has made me forget all my hardship and my father's house. He's looking back on all that's happened to him, all of those ups and downs. He also says in verse 52, God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. Notice for Joseph that even though his life is this roller coaster of existence since he was 17, he still acknowledges God. It is God that made him forget all of his hardships. It is God who made him fruitful in the land of his affliction. And as predicted in the dream, that is Pharaoh's dream, the 7 years of plenty come to an end, and the 7 years of famine now begin. If you think about Joseph's life that's in the chart, that's constant up and down, it's really no different than ours. Different stuff. His may be more severe than ours, or maybe ours could be more severe than his, but life is like that, isn't it? It's ups and downs and ups and downs, and it ultimately leads to, if you know Jesus, to the up. It's called glory. Joseph doesn't stay in the sweet spot for 7 years. After the 7 years, the famine comes. Everybody in the world in that area at that time experiences the difficulty of famine. But God is actively at work in it all. In our lives, we have plenty of seasons or stretches of down and also stretches of being up. But the ultimate end, we know for those who know Jesus, is beyond this world, it's glory. Notice what happens in the 7 years of famine, starting in verse 53. The 7 years of plenty that occurred in the land of Egypt came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began to come. As Joseph had said, there was famine in all the lands, but in all the land of Egypt there was bread. Why? Because God saw fit to bring Joseph to Egypt with the plan put in place to save lives, to prepare the people for the famine that would hit the then known world at that time. God instituted and made it happen so that this would happen. Verse 56, when all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread. Pharaoh said to all the Egyptians, go to Joseph, what he says to you, do. So when the famine had spread over all the land, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe in all the land of Egypt. Moreover, all the earth came to Joseph to buy grain, because the famine was severe over all the earth. All. It's brutal famine. And it is this famine, by God's design, God brought this about into the land, brought Joseph into the land to help in the midst of all of the famine that was coming. And this far-reaching famine sweeps across the land, reaches all the way to where Joseph's family is, where Jacob and the brothers are, all the way into Canaan. And this forces Joseph's father, Jacob, it forces him to send his sons to Egypt to look for food. And that's where we pick up in 42. And in 42, chapter 42, verses 1 through 6, we read these words. When Jacob learned that there was grain for sale in Egypt, he said to his sons, "Why do you look at one another?" And he said, "Behold, I have heard that there is grain for sale in Egypt. Go down and buy grain for us there, that we may live and not die." So 10 of Joseph's brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt, but Jacob did not send Benjamin, Joseph's brother, with his brothers, for he feared that harm might happen to him. Thus the sons of Israel came to buy among the others who came, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. Now Joseph was governor over the land. Jacob doesn't send his son Benjamin, who's the actual blood brother, actually, of Joseph. He's the youngest, because Jacob hasn't really, doesn't seem like Jacob's changed at all, quite frankly, in the story when you read it. He still hangs on to the favored son. He now has a new favored son. It's Benjamin. He doesn't want to send him. He'll send the other 10. But the other 10, nonetheless, they're sent there by Joseph, and they come into land. And it's right here in this account, starting right in verse 6, that we pick it up. And it's here that after approximately 22 years, remember, Joseph was 30 years of age, and then there's 7 years of famine, or of plenty, I mean, and it's around 2 years into the famine, roughly. We know this from later in the book of Genesis. So around 22 years total since he's seen his brothers. And it's right here in this account that after approximately 22 years, Joseph comes face to face with those who hurt him. Wow. Face to face. Remember, Joseph, just prior to this, we're told in chapter 1, has been in 7 years of plenty, and he said, "God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house." He's forgotten all the hardship, and now, of all times, now, after 22 years, he comes face to face with those who hurt him. What was forgotten is contrasted now with what's standing right in front of him, and the roles have been 100% reversed. Now Joseph is in this powerful position in Egypt. He has the opportunity to repay these guys. He has a huge chance to retaliate. Those who've deeply wounded him, and really because of what they did to them, they radically altered the entire course of his life. He's had 22 years to think about, what would I do if I got my hands on those guys? And here he is. I mean, he could right now send them away empty-handed and starve them all to death. He could, if he wanted to, put them all in prison just to rot and die. He could have them all executed on the spot. He could decide to go Liam Neeson on every one of them. Would you blame him if he did in some ways? I mean, these brothers should pay for what they did, shouldn't they? I mean, it's just criminal. It's wrong. I mean, that would be just, wouldn't it? I mean, these guys deserve payback. That would be fair. So what actually happens? We pick up the account, Genesis chapter 42, verse 7. Let's start in verse 6, actually. Now Joseph was governor over the land. He was the one who sold to all the people of the land. And Joseph's brothers came and bowed themselves before him with their faces to the ground. Joseph saw his brothers and recognized them, but treated them like strangers and spoke roughly to them. Joseph saw all of his brothers and recognized them, the text says. And verse 8, Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. Our text tells us what I think would be maybe an indication, and we have to be careful a little bit not to read into Joseph's feelings too much here. It's easy to insert ourselves into the text. If you've been deeply wounded by someone, it's really easy to read into this text your feelings and your emotions. I think there's a little part of this where we should do that, though, honestly. We want to be careful because we want the text to speak, and we don't want to make the text say something the text doesn't say. We should never do that. But this is a mirror to our lives, isn't it? We should hold this up as a mirror and go, oh, I've been hurt. You look at Joseph and just saying, they don't even know it's him, and he treats them like strangers. He speaks roughly to them. It's like, that's the least these guys should get, at least this. It's understandable. I can't help it when I read this account. I can't help but think about, after 22 years, all of these emotions possibly for Joseph just flooding into him and rising to the surface. Maybe. Or we can paint Joseph with a brush that he's so magnificently holy and perfect that he just doesn't have any feelings at all. I will tell you what's fascinating about this, though, is we're about to get a glimpse into the emotions of Joseph. If you remember 37 down through 41, chapter 37 to 41, Joseph has no emotion at all. Like we're not told nothing about anything about his emotional response or state during all of the difficulties and trials. He's almost robotic-like in terms of moving from one problem to the next problem to the next problem. But here, face-to-face with his brothers, emotions come up. I'll tell you this. This week I was sitting, this doesn't happen very often, but I was sitting at a different coffee shop where my daughter works, and I was looking at this text, and I was reflecting on it, and I was in tears because the emotion of this text and the pain that I personally maybe was reading into Joseph that he was experiencing as a reflection of, I know actually what it's like to be deeply wounded. It's hard. It hurts so bad. And there he is. So suddenly, out of nowhere, Joseph is confronted with all that's happened to him. He has to remember all of the pain, all the loss, all the sorrow, all the things that could have been or should have been, and they are not. When we're deeply wounded, it's really hard to move on, isn't it? It's so hard to trust. It's really hard to heal. It's hard to forgive. It's hard to reconcile. It's hard not to wish the worst for people that have hurt you, for them to suffer the way that they caused you to suffer. And even though Joseph treated his brothers like strangers and spoke roughly to them, I want you to see what happens in verse 9. Notice this in verse 9. It's so significant. In chapter 42, verse 9, it says, and Joseph remembered. Remember, he'd forgotten all the things in his father's house, all the afflictions and troubles he had. Now his brothers are face to face. He remembers all of that. But that event, seeing them face to face, causes him now to remember what? To remember the dreams that he had dreamed of them. Remember going all the way back to 37, what happened? In chapter 37, you know, here's this 17-year-old guy. He's the favored son of the dad who has this coat of many colors given to him. And he goes to his brothers for whatever reason. And you're like, dude, what are you doing? You're just making this worse for yourself. That's what it looks like in the text. And he tells them, guys, I had a dream. Here's the dream. And his brothers hear the dream. And they're like, that sounds to me like you're saying, Joseph, that you're going to rule over all of us and we're going to bow down to you someday. This is the dream he remembers. A dream actually that was given to him by God when he was 17. And now how long has it been? It's been 22 years. 22 years. And in that moment, he remembers it.
And when he remembers the dream, what does he remember? I think in the remembrance of the dream, he remembers God, that God gave him the dream, a dream that he shared with his brothers. And I think it's possible at this point that Joseph now maybe begins to see with a little more clarity God's purpose and plan unfolding with more clarity and crispness maybe than before. All the pain and suffering that he'd experienced in the past maybe begins to take a little bit of shape and form because he goes, oh, my brothers are here. This is like, the dream is actually, it's actually coming to pass. And here am I in Egypt, and it's a famine. And he's starting to do the math on this. It's not that he didn't know that God gave him the dream in the past, but remember, he's had all these years with no fulfillment of the dream at all in his life and probably forgot about it at one point and just put it out of his mind and this is not going to happen, and then it's all of a sudden in front of him. By God's design, God put him into a face-to-face situation because God not only wanted to do a work in his brother's life and in his life, but also in the nation of Egypt and the surrounding people to spare them. God is at work in all of their souls. What happens next in chapters 42 and 43? Let's give you a quick scan of the chapters because there's much in there, but we will scan it. What does Joseph do with his, quite honestly, undeserving brothers? I mean, they don't deserve anything, do they? Well, several things take place. First of all, in verses 9 through 14, he accuses them here in the text of being spies. He knows they're not spies, but they don't recognize him, and he's like, I'm going to accuse these guys of being spies, that all you're here, you're coming into Egypt, and you're checking out the land because you seek to do harm. He knows that's not the case. But secondly, in verses 15 through 17, he devises a test that he puts them through. And he begins the test, first of all, by saying, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to keep all of you in jail here, in custody, and I'm going to send one of you back home. And then he decides, no, I'm going to put all of you in custody for 3 days. So all of them are locked up for 3 days. Now, at this point, honestly, for me, when I read this text, a lot of commentators, they don't do this. And so work with me a little bit on this. You don't have to agree with me, of course, on this. I find it hard not to see Joseph battling with himself a little bit here. He's trying to figure out, what do I do? On the one hand, he's like, I really want to see my brother Benjamin. I want to know that he's alive. So he's going to put his brothers through the test to make sure that he gets a chance to do that. So it could be that his just hands are really clean on this, and he's like, that's my one goal. But it also could be that he's like, I don't know what I want to do here with this. There's a bit of struggle. There's pain that's developed. But again, we have to be careful not to read too much into it. And I just want to share that with you as I reflect on the text. That's how I reflect on it, but I'm humble enough on it to go, I'm not sure. We got to be careful. But here he is wrestling with this. He locks them all up for 3 days. After the 3 days happen, what does he do? He says to them, here's the new game plan. All of you will go back home, and now one of you will stay. And it's going to be Simeon. We don't exactly know why it's Simeon, but Simeon gets to stay. Where does he get to stay? He's locked up in custody. So all the brothers, they end up going home. He presents that test to them, and he sends them all back home, and the goal of the test is to see how the brothers are going to respond. Are these the same guys from 22 years ago? Is my brother Benjamin even alive? Did they take care of him just like they took care of me? Joseph wants to know this information. Take note of what happens in verses 21 through 24. When Joseph tells them that this is the plan, starting in chapter 42, verse 21, then they said to one another, in truth, we are guilty concerning our brother, and that we saw the distress of his soul when he begged us, and we did not listen. This is the first window we get into the distress that Joseph had in chapter 37. It's a window through the eyes of his brothers. They said, we are guilty. We saw the distress of his soul when he begged us and we did not listen. That is why this distress has come upon us. And Reuben answered them, did I not tell you not to sin against the boy, but you did not listen. So now there comes a reckoning for his blood. 22 years later, these brothers are feeling the weight of guilt in their lives. 22 years. Sit with that for a moment. I mean, imagine this. What the brothers did was horrible, and they had to live with the burden of that. They had to live with the weight of that in them. They had to live with the sin gnawing away at them, sin eating away at them day after day, knowing that they did that. They had to live for 22 years with the lie that they told to their dad that Joseph was eaten by wild beasts, that they never confessed to their father and told them. The guilt, however, causes them to think that what they're going through right now is a result of their sin. God's paying us back. I think for us what we want to do is we want to appreciate, if we can call it appreciate, the fact that this is what sin does, doesn't it? It sits like a rock in us, like a rock in our stomach. When we're carrying around unconfessed, unrepentant sin, when we are carrying around for years relationships that are not reconciled or lives that have been ruined and destroyed, when we're carrying that around, it is a weight. It is a pain. We think of Joseph in this story, of course, and rightly so. But there's also the brothers. When Joseph hears his brother's admission of guilt, notice that he turns away in verse 24. So Joseph overhears this, right? He hears the brothers. Then he turned away from them and wept. Yeah, you can see why he would. After 22 years, he finally heard his brothers say, "We're guilty." We heard his cries of distress and we carried out this evil act in his life. Who wouldn't weep? Sometimes that's all you want, isn't it? When somebody really hurts you, wounds you. You just sometimes want somebody to say, "I'm sorry." Some acknowledgement, some little nugget, tidbit. It's something that you can hang on to. But sometimes people don't get that at all, ever. There's never a closure for some people. But Joseph got a little window into the hearts of his brothers here. You know, it's likely that he's waited such a long time to hear this admission. Maybe for years he wanted this. I don't know. We don't know. The text doesn't tell us. I can tell you that I've gone through significant pain and hurt. I've been through church stuff that's been really hurtful and hard over the years of ministry that I've been in. Surprise, surprise, welcome to life, right? We're people, we hurt people, people hurt us. It's life. Things that shouldn't be are. And there are times that you want somebody to say, "I'm sorry," and it never comes forward, and you offer an apology, and you try to fix things and reconcile, but the person never reciprocates. Joseph is in one of those moments right here. How does the rest of 42 and 43 play out? Well, in Genesis 43, the rest of it is this. Joseph sends all the brothers home with the food, but he's filled their bags full of grain, and he keeps Simeon in custody. The brothers then arrive back home in Canaan to their father, Jacob, and Jacob then realizes that, wait a second, where's Simeon, my son? At this point, Reuben, he says to his father, "Listen, we're supposed to go back. We're supposed to go back and we're supposed to bring Benjamin, your favorite son. We're supposed to bring him back, and then when we bring him back, Simeon will be released." But he's holding them custody until that happens. Jacob doesn't move quickly here at all. You get to chapter 43, and it begins with, "Now the famine was severe in the land, and when they had eaten the grain that they had brought from Egypt, their father said to them, 'Go again, buy grain, buy us a little food.'" Jacob waits till they're completely out of food again before he even bothers to send. He doesn't want to send his favored son. He is sending a message to all of his brothers, the message that he's always sent. I have a favorite. I have a favorite. But nonetheless, during this time, Reuben, he rises up and he says, hey, listen, we do have to go. And when we go, just know that if I don't bring back Benjamin, I'll take responsibility for the youngest. If I don't bring him back safely, you can kill my two kids. What a nice guy, right? You get into chapter 43 when they run out of food, and now Judah steps forward. Remember Judah, the dirty guy from chapter 38? Judah steps forward, and we have to look at maybe indications of heart change possibly in the life of Judah, perhaps in some of the brothers' hearts too. Judah, what does he say in verses 8 through 10? He basically says, listen, I will take care of Benjamin, and I'll bring him back alive. And if he doesn't come back alive, my life in exchange for his. You can have my life. I will sacrifice myself. So in chapter 43, as that famine continues, finally Jacob is again forced into a situation where he has to send Benjamin, and they're sent out with the brothers on their way back to Egypt. And we pick up the account now in chapter 43, verses 15 and following. It says, so the men took this present, and they took double the money with them, and Benjamin. Then they arose and went down to Egypt and stood before Joseph. They're back. Who knows how long Simeon's been sitting in custody, but they're back. And they're back now with Benjamin. What will Joseph do now? How does he respond now again that he's face to face with these brothers who heard him, and now his youngest brother is present? In chapter 43, verses 16, all the way to the end of the chapter, we discover this about Joseph, that at every single turn, Joseph gives mercy and grace to his undeserving brothers instead of judgment and wrath. That's what he does. He actually already extended grace to them back in chapter 42 when they first showed up. In chapter 42, verse 25, if you go back to that verse, you recognize that when he sent them back home to Jacob, when he sent those brothers, he filled their bags, it says, with grain, and he replaced every man's money in his sack. In other words, they came with money to buy food, and he sends them back with their grain bags full, and he gives them their money back as well. These are not the actions of a bitter and unforgiving man. When Joseph comes face to face with his brothers, he gives mercy. And he gives grace. They are undeserving. They actually deserve wrath and judgment. They deserve somebody maybe to take out vengeance on them. Joseph, I think, recognizes that it's not his to do that. In chapter 43, verses 16 through 34, the end of this chapter, as we go through it, I want to show you how he gives even more grace. Let's take a look at his actions. What does Joseph do? In verse 16 of chapter 43, when Joseph saw Benjamin with him, he said to the steward of his house, bring the men into the house and slaughter an animal and make ready, for the men are to dine with me at noon. Hardly the words of a bitter man. He invites his brothers rather to a feast in his house. In verse 24 of chapter 43, we read that when the man had brought the men into Joseph's house and given them water and washed their feet, and we had given the donkeys fodder, they prepared the present for Joseph's coming at noon. For they heard that they should eat bread there. He gives his brothers, through the people that work for him, they wash his feet, they provide fodder for their donkeys. Hardly the behavior of a bitter man. When Joseph finally sees them again in verses 27 and 28, notice what happens. Joseph inquires about their welfare and said, is your father well, the old man of whom you spoke? Is he still alive? They said, your servant, our father, is well. He's still alive. And they bowed their heads and prostrated themselves. And he lifted his eyes and saw his brother Benjamin, his master's son. He's inquiring here in verse 27 about the well-being of his father, but also their well-being. Hardly the actions of a bitter man. In verses 29 to 31, he's absolutely overwhelmed with emotion when he sees his brother Benjamin again. Notice this. And he lifted up his eyes and saw his brother Benjamin, his mother's son, and said, "Is this your youngest brother of whom you spoke to me? God be gracious to you, my son." Then Joseph hurried out of for his compassion grew warm for his brother, and he sought a place to weep, and he entered the chamber and wept there. The emotion of Joseph. And then in verses 31 to 34, what does he do? He serves them the feast. He washed his face. He came out controlling himself. He gets in front of them and he says, "Serve the food." And they feast. That's what they do. The men looked at one another. His brothers are looking at one another. They don't even know this is Joseph. But they look at one another in amazement. They don't even really fully realize the grace that they've been given as undeserving people. They're in amazement. When they find out, which we're not there this morning, when they find out that Joseph is the one and they are the recipients of this amazing grace that's poured out to them, can you imagine? It just ends in the chapter that they drank and were merry with him. Hardly the response of a Liam Neeson. Not even close. Not even close. How does this account from the life of Joseph touch our lives today? How does this apply for us? I want to give you three things to consider. First of all, Joseph is an incredible example of what it looks like to give grace to someone who's hurt you deeply. When you come face to face with those who hurt you, what is your response? Now, it's so easy. It's easier, let me put it that way, if the pain was inflicted here and you've moved a long way away and you don't see those people at all, it's easier to separate and distant, right? But if you're not in that situation and you see them, or it's been years and you finally do have an encounter with them, Joseph serves up this incredible example. It makes us ask ourselves, what would my response be? You know, I mean, we all know that people do horrible things to other people. There are some absolutely horrific things that have been done to people. When I was a pastor in Utah, church planting there, a woman came to our church who, at the time, was probably in her late 50s, I would say, and she just wanted to, I guess, talk and tell me that she was sexually assaulted by her dad from the time she was a little girl all the way up until she was 18. And at 18, she fought back, and she left the house, never to return again. But she always lived around her dad. Her dad was sick by this point, and I didn't have much to say. What do you say? You know, you point to a person, to the ultimate one, the one who will ultimately bring justice, because no justice is being brought right now for her situation or at that time. She came back a while later, and she was in tears, and she said, my father died. He passed away. She's like, I just wanted one little acknowledgement, one thing from him, just to acknowledge that what he did to me was wrong, but there was nothing. See, she had, in that sense, no closure. She didn't have the opportunity like a Joseph has, and sometimes we're like that. We don't have that, right? But sometimes you do have face-to-face encounters with people who have hurt you, and how will we respond? Are you here today and you have something like that and you're holding on to this what feels like a right to be angry? A right to be bitter or hateful or desirous of their harm or vengeance? Or are you willing to extend grace and mercy? I don't think that the answer to this is you just flick a switch. When you've been hurt, wounded deeply, you don't just flick a switch. It's a journey. It is. But when we hold on to the pain and do not pursue forgiveness, even if that person is no longer around, when we hold it on to it, we end up actually hurting ourselves more than anyone else at this point, because we put ourselves into this self-imposed prison of bitterness. And I don't think God wants you to carry that. I think God wants you to help you to find freedom from that. Please understand, I'm not at all suggesting that's an easy thing. But I have a hard time believing that God would want you to continue to carry that. I have every reason to believe that God would want to help you to heal. So is there someone that you need to forgive? Someone you need to be reconciled to or try to reconcile to? And could it be this morning that the Holy Spirit is prompting you to just take a step in that direction? You don't have to go all the way, but just take a step. And then to take another step. And then take another step. Secondly, Joseph's brothers, I think, are a reminder to us all that sometimes we are the ones who actually do the inflicting of wounds. After 22 years, Joseph's brothers still carried the guilt of what they had done. But they did not need to carry it anymore. They didn't. And actually, neither do we. We don't need to carry and hold on to guilt. We actually can find forgiveness for our sins, right? In relationships with others, we can actually, if they're alive still, we can actually, if we've been the ones who've caused the harm, we can attempt to go to others and to seek reconciliation. And maybe it's one step at a time, but to move in the direction. We can also go to God. We can go to Him and we can seek His forgiveness and restoration as well, for no matter what you have done, period, He's a God of great mercy and grace. So is there something that you've done that you just need to make right? Something or someone you have wronged? Is there a sin that you need to confess and repent of? And is it possible that this morning the Holy Spirit could be prompting you to take steps towards that? The removal of that, the guilt, the shame, that there might be forgiveness that is received by you. And then thirdly, his account here of his story is a great reminder of the good news of Jesus Christ. It's an incredible, incredible reminder of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a reminder that like Joseph's brothers, all of us are sinners. We all carry the guilt of sin in our lives. But Jesus came into this world and He extended grace to undeserving sinners like us. And He did that when He died on the cross to forgive us of our sins and was raised to life. There's not a single one of us, not a single one of us, that doesn't need the undeserved grace of God in Jesus Christ. He was brutally treated, falsely accused, rejected by people, taken to the cross. And while He's on the cross, He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And on the cross, He died for sinners. We are sinners, undeserving people. And He gives grace to you and me. He Himself is the perfect example for us of what we should do with other people, is He not? And you know, this morning, friends, we get the joy of living in that reality. If you've accepted Jesus Christ, you get the joy of living in that, basking in the grace and the mercy of God. And this morning, you get the opportunity in a moment to come to either one of these tables for communion, this reminder to each of us of the undeserving grace that we have received. And we get an opportunity to give thanks to God for the mercy that He's extended to us. And ask that, God, would you help me to be one who extends your mercy and grace to others. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for your word. And Lord, I want to pray for those here this morning who this has been a hard message maybe for, because maybe they are on the side of on Joseph's, where they have been wounded deeply, or maybe they're on the side where they look back at maybe some wounds they've inflicted but haven't been made right. Lord, I want to pray that you would meet all of us, regardless of where we're at, and that you would touch our hearts, Lord. We're thankful, God, for your grace. Thank you for your mercy, Lord. Lord, we ask for forgiveness for times that we've held on and have not been forgiving. Lord, we ask for your help just to take a step in the right direction, Lord, and that, Lord, you'd take us by the hand and that you'd lead us one step at a time. We thank you for your patience with us and your mercy to us. But Lord, move us in the direction that you want us to go on this. Lord, we ask for your power for that. We can't do that on our own. Forgiving others and receiving forgiveness is not, it's a divine work, Lord. It's a spiritual work. It is a work that we need the power of your Holy Spirit in our lives to have happen. And so, Lord, we just invite your power in our lives to give us the strength that we need, that we would fully rely upon and depend upon you and your touch, and that, Lord, you would go before us, and your Lord, you would mend and you would heal, you would restore and you would forgive and you would reconcile, Lord, and we just lay all of those things to you, Lord. And Lord, we just give you thanks and praise for who you are, for what you will do. In the name of Jesus, we ask this. Amen. Amen.